Over the past 25 years of teaching, writing books, and giving clinics all over the world, this question has rocketed to the top of the leaderboard in terms of the frequency with which it is asked. What should I practice? Let's start with why. You have to ask this of yourself before you do anything. And if you're brutally honest in terms of the commitment level when you give the answer, the path will appear in front of you and will remain clearly defined as long as your honesty remains intact. So what should you practice? I want to look at an example of where I've heard this question the most often and most recently, which is music score. Most higher education establishments, like the ones shown here, will give you a four-year curriculum of topics you must work on to become a better musician and will take varying degrees of insanity level fees from you in the process. Unfortunately, I think the two things that are fundamental to the beginning, the middle, and the future of your journey as a musician are the two things that are almost impossible for a school to offer in a curriculum. They are curiosity and experience. A music school may, over the course of your studies, be able to offer you some experience, but it will almost always be tied to the curriculum you're paying those exorbitant fees to follow and won't be exclusively linked to your curiosity. And yes, there are sometimes some amazing teachers at these schools that will encourage you to follow your curiosity and be a positive influence on your development as a musician. But if you're serious enough about jazz and improvised music to commit to paying tens of thousands of dollars a year for multiple years to study it somewhere, then I think you have to ask yourself why you're not just as committed to do the hard work on your own, saving your money and moving somewhere in the world that it makes sense for you to develop your sound. The reality of getting that piece of paper at the end of your degree course is that it allows you to do two things and two things only: study more or teach. So when people ask me what is it they should be practicing to be a better jazz musician, there are a lot of layers to peel back before you get to the beginning of the path you might want to walk down. I must add that the network is probably the most valuable element of going to music school, but unless you have a scholarship, it's a crap ton of money to spend simply on meeting people. And if you're going to be a professional musician, you really need to know how to interact and communicate with other players. So it's far cheaper to go to a city like New York or Los Angeles, Berlin, Barcelona, and just start hanging with the people you want to work with. I always say that the music business, the music industry, is kind of 5% actually playing and doing music and about 95% dealing with and communicating with people. Now let's look at the situation of a more casual musician where the stakes are perhaps a little lower and the rest of your life isn't dependent on the decisions and hard work you're about to put in your mid to late teens. Just like the college student, I think you have to ask yourself what your level of commitment is and ultimately what your goals are. It definitely still comes down to curiosity and experience, and that is going to be fueled primarily by listening to music both recorded and live. Like, what is it about that gig you saw last week that made you want to be able to do what you saw those musicians doing on stage? Was it a sound thing? Was it a time thing? Did you love the compositions? Were you singing the melodies all the way home? Was the energy of the solos making you feel things you hadn't felt before? And what was it about the performance that you didn't understand but want to know how to replicate? These were the kinds of things I was asking myself after every show I went to as a kid. I would record everything I heard on a little tape machine and then rush home after the show, transcribe everything I could, and then stay up all night practicing it. This is perhaps a great example of curiosity leading the way, defining the path, and fueling the desire to do the work at any cost. This is what all of my musical heroes have in common. Everyone we've ever heard that has a unique voice has been through this intense period of curiosity fueling the work. Most of them didn't go to music school. Most of them don't have a degree. Most of them still exhibit that intense level of curiosity to this day and are constantly trying to reinvent themselves and find new sounds. So as perhaps a more casual musician or hobbyist, you simply have to find your spot on that spectrum and ask yourself, what do you want out of playing this music? As long as you stay honest, you'll always get to stay positive about the process and get the most enjoyment out of playing. Okay, and here we are some minutes into the video and I hear you saying, but Janek, what do you have to practice. Look, I think aside from the basics and foundation of your instrument, which should be a given for any serious or semi-serious musician, you have to practice the thing that screams the loudest. You have to be aware of where your attention is pulled most often and where your skill set is most lacking. Is that motivic development on jazz standards? Is that a better command of the altissimo range of your tenor saxophone? Is that a more smooth sound in the middle register of your trumpet? Only you know that. And only your honesty will unlock the next chapter of your development. As a writer, a composer, an educator, a soloist, a bass player, and an artist, my only job, aside from the work I do for my personal journey as a musician, is to help unlock that next chapter of your development. That's why I document my process not just in videos like this on YouTube, but in books like Iconic Lines. This question we're talking about today, this concept of where do I go and what do I work on, is the exact reason for this book. It outlines the basic sounds of jazz vocabulary over the past 100 years and is designed to help pique your curiosity and help you on your journey of dealing with improvised music. Both physical and digital copies are linked below in the description of this video if you want to check this book out. And both forms of the book come with over 300 play-alongs and over 70 videos. I want to highlight something that I've always had to be honest about with myself when it comes to developing my sound and increasing my range of vocabulary as an improvising musician. I know that I have to continually be transcribing, learning, and subsequently forgetting vocabulary as much as possible. I really don't want to sound like I'm playing licks, so that's where the forgetting part of the process comes in. Don't get me wrong, I work on each line I transcribe for days and sometimes weeks until it is a completely natural part of my playing. But I don't want to be conscious of the line when I go to improvise. I want it to come out like a natural extension of my playing and not sound forced at all. So here's a little look at what that process looks like. I'm constantly listening to music, so finding a line or an idea never takes me that long. And this line from Joe Zawinul that's in the Iconic Lines book takes us from a 1 minor chord to a 5 dominant chord. And back to the root again. The line is simple, it's melodic, it's swinging, it has everything I'm listening for in a great line. And my process is to make sure I have all the notes down, check out a few different fingerings if it's not totally obvious at first, and then get to work on it with great sound and great time. That can sometimes be completely alone. Sometimes it can be with a metronome. And sometimes it'll be with a looper or some kind of play-along like the ones that come with the book. One, two, one, two, three, and... Once I'm dialed into the time and the sound of the line, the repetition is the biggest key here. It could just be an afternoon of this if time is short, but it could also be 4 or 5 days just working on this line and trying to work it over as many different sets of chord changes as possible. 12 keys is a must, and being able to use it at will when this cadence appears in a song is a great discipline for your practice routine. But again, try and get to the forgetting about it stage. That's when it becomes natural, and I think that's when it changes from practice to honesty. Iconic Lines is not a curriculum. It's a starting point for your curiosity. If you're not familiar with the basic history of jazz and which eras produced which sounds and which awesome players, then it's a great journey through the masters of the music. And my sincere hope is that you find just one line in here that speaks to you, that makes you want to stop whatever it is you're doing and practice it for hours. A line that makes you want to know everything about the musician that played it and what albums that musician made and what iconic moments of jazz history they were a part of. I appreciate you spending some time with me today and for making it this far in the video. Again, Iconic Lines is linked below, and both physical and digital versions of the book come with all the play-alongs and videos. Don't forget to hit the thumbs up and subscribe to the channel if you dig what you've been watching, and I'll see you on the next video.